of the living deep.
All right, what's up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the LHG Cast. I am Taylor Hoyt. With me, as always, is Connor White.
Reporting for duty.
The man with the rock star energy drink.
Sweet title.
It wasn't a title. I'm just saying right now you have a rock star.
I thought you were going down some path where like, I'm a rock star or something, but not
nope.
The case.
No. Perfect. You're the man with the rock star, not person. Yeah.
Lifestyle? Attitude?
Drink. We also have Mr. Nick Lynn.
Hello.
The normal host.
Oh.
He decided to change it today. We're just mixing it all up. And then at the end, Mr. Jake Bianchi. How are you, sir?
Sometimes called the man with the plan.
Sometimes called the man with the plan.
Otherwise known as
Jake Bianchi.
So we had quite the crammed week. There was lots of games that came out. There was a press conference in Paris that we're going to talk about. Lots of games were announced.
Mm-hmm.
Things happened. It's got a giant list that we're going to go through.
And it is extensive, let me tell you,
for
the viewers at home, sports fans.
At least some of them are pretty tiny, so we could get through them really quick.
Yeah. Sure.
But I think that means it's like, you know, maybe small rants.
Yeah.
Small rants.
Yeah, we'll keep it reined in. So,
I'm going to burp right now.
Oh, well, that's
Why lovely.
Thanks for tuning in.
Yeah.
That was GCast every week on YouTube.
Okay, so to Paris Games Week, let's just jump right on in.
Get this garbage truck rolling.
No bodily function news there.
So, have you guys ever heard of Paris Games Week?
Nope, never.
Exactly.
I'll be honest. The only place that I'm really caring about this week is Detroit.
We'll get there.
All right. So back to Paris.
I'm tantalized.
Yeah, Paris Games Week. Sony decided to have their conference, their GamesCon. Is it GamesCon?
Yeah. So
GamesCon conference then.
GamesCon and E3 were really close together this year for some reason. And so instead of doing one right after the other, they're like, oh, we're just going to wait till Paris Games Week and do one there.
Yeah.
With the hype build back up a little bit.
Exactly.
And they did deliver that. Let's begin really, really fast. Street Fighter V.
Well, actually, who actually watched Paris Games?
Oh, I did.
Okay, yeah. Just to assign roles here. So, Taylor and Nick, you watched it.
Yes.
Connor, what do you know about it?
This is the first I've heard of the PGS, because it's cool enough to have an acronym now.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So, I will ask questions when I feel appropriate.
Did you like know anything about the games? Or,
no, I didn't.
I know like maybe two of them. So, I think we'll
be your...
Yeah. So, Connor, you and I... It's time for us to do some learning.
All right, let's learn, dude. Bring me along, teach.
All right, so this is not in any order. I'm just going to put what I put on the list.
Sure.
Of course, the biggest news and best news is Street Fighter V got a new character announced. And
that's an unbiased opinion.
I know. Dalsim was joining. He looks way different than before. None of you guys care because you don't care about fighting games.
I'm really, really surprised that Dalsim is in the game.
I know. Actually, I am.
But he's got like he's got a turban now. And he's got a giant beard.
He looks awesome.
Is Ryu also in the game?
No.
Oh, wow.
He's not actually.
He's on the cover, but he's not in the game.
Yeah, he's not in the game anymore. He's kind of like a background character. But yeah, he looks a lot faster.
His body twists a lot more. Like,
yeah,
as opposed to just stretching straight.
Yeah, yeah.
Like he was like doing these corkscrew type things. Yeah, it was interesting.
He looked cool. Can't wait to see what people find out about him with moves and combos,
because
I do not care about that character, because he has like this weird, he's like really slow and floaty, and I do not like that at all.
Interesting.
Another big news was February 16th next year is its release date.
That was a little sooner than I was expecting. I was thinking March maybe, but February it is.
Yeah, it's kind of coming right up.
It's actually on June, so this is awesome.
It's going to give a lot of time to practice for Evo.
There you go.
Hint, hint.
Boom. Haven't talked about that in a while. Yep.
And then more news is that there's going to be 5 characters released over the next year.
And they have one more character to announce for the full roster, right? There's one left?
Yes.
Okay.
One left.
Is there a bunch of core characters that are still that are still missing? Like, so it'll probably be them, or is there any chances there might be a new character?
There are core characters missing, but these are not going to be them. You could tell by the silhouettes that they announced that they don't look like core characters.
Like, I was surprised there's no Akuma. Like, that's the one big shocker to me, at least.
I have a feeling that he's going to be an unlock in the game.
He's always a fan favorite.
Yeah. Like, if you look at high-level play, he's always one of the top characters. So it's kind of interesting for them to leave him out.
Right. And it's like, there's a lot of people who, like, given the choice, are going to pick, like, the fiery evil demon dude.
Exactly.
So you gotta have that in there.
Speaking of which, I'm serious. I mean, I've been saying this for so long. If Asura is in the game, I'm winning Evo. I'm going to play it so much. Winning Evo is going to be like an afternoon like hobby. It's just going to be like, I just want to play it so much, though. So
a quick jaunt through the park.
Yeah.
So Capcom, you better...
you know your special character.
Yeah. Yeah. If you want to make costume, Evo boring, man. You know, then you release Asura.
Yeah, exactly. If you want it to be extremely one-sided because of this guy over here.
And also Leon from Resident Evil, just because why not?
And Cloud from Final Fantasy VII.
Yeah. And Sonic.
Yes.
And Donald Trump.
We're getting crazy, just why not?
Let's make America kick ass again.
And then he uppercuts somebody.
You're fired.
You've got my vote.
Not really, but anyways, moving on.
Yes.
That was good. I like that.
Anything else about Street Fighter?
No, that's pretty much it. That's pretty cool. I can't wait to see the next character.
Sweet.
Can't wait to play it at PSX like all of us are going to do, right?
Yeah.
Totes.
Oh, right. Shogun.
Next one.
All right. New Horizon footage was shown. They showed actual gameplay.
That's that robot dinosaur. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Nice.
All I heard is robot dinosaur, and I like was jolted awake.
You remember that one from E3? Where is the caveman living kind of post-apocalyptic?
Oh, yeah.
Robot dinosaurs.
Yeah, another one. Yeah,
I guess new gameplay for that then?
Yeah, they showed actual, like they showed him actually playing it. Like,
really?
Yeah.
As opposed to just teaser footage?
It was gameplay, but no one was really playing it.
Mm-hmm.
So E3, obviously, it looked like gameplay, but it also looked very scripted, very practiced.
Definitely.
How does the game look in comparison?
Looks exactly the same.
The only thing, I couldn't tell if my stream was bad, but it looked like the framing was worse.
It was a stream. The stream had some hiccups. But
it
looked awesome. They're like setting up traps and stuff like that. It's an RPG. Crafting and scavenging is...
Level system?
I think so.
Okay.
Scavenging is really important, so you have to harvest certain robot dinosaurs to find different materials, and you could build like better bows, better arrows, and stuff like that.
So it's just like crazy whacked out futuristic version of Turok or something.
Yeah, more or less. Yeah, but they're like, but the people are like cavemen. It's really cool.
But wait, this is bad. This is bad, guys. I just got my first vibe of that same feel of Shadow of Mordor and Mad Max.
Uh oh.
It's like if it's going to be one of those open world things where it has a lot to do with crafting and just this weird. I don't know what it was about those two games, but they felt so similar, and they just ended up getting so boring so quickly. Hmm. Even though they had cool cinematics, cool story, it's just something about the gameplay killed me.
Hmm. It's like...
Well, they all come from the same pool of developers. They're both WB games, so I'm wondering if everybody was just sharing ideas, but this is a Sony game.
This is Guerrilla Games.
Yeah,
the
Guerrilla...
guys who made Killzone, which is
this
crazy.
Is their first RPG. They've never done a game like this.
And they're trying to make an RPG, like an actual RPG, like Skyrim, stuff like that.
Okay. Yeah,
cool, sweet.
So that looks cool.
I feel like the concept is interesting enough where it could kind of help drive the gameplay too.
Yeah,
it's just being like the wacky world of robot dinosaurs and cavemen.
I don't know.
It sounds interesting enough. You know,
sounds really interesting. Well, to me, the
mystery is like, why are there robot dinosaurs and why are there cavemen? Like,
right. Maybe it's like some Xenogears, like to some hyper ancient civilization that's like been destroyed. Or something.
Yeah, you never know.
But that's
what hooks. That's what I'm hooked about. Like that, I
want
to find out that mystery.
Know what happened.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
He looks like he wants something. You look like he wants.
Well, yeah.
Assuming
we're moving on. Assuming that you know this one's kind of done.
Right.
There was something on the list that I just realized. I don't know if this is relevant or not, or if, I can't remember if you guys talked about it last week. Far Cry Primal.
We didn't really talk about that. No.
That got announced a while ago.
Yeah.
That was like 2 weeks, wasn't it?
At least. Maybe more than that. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Really? Okay. Well, never mind then. Sorry. Yeah. I couldn't remember if it was...
There's an interesting trend of all these like cavemen type games. There's another one we're going to talk about too that's also similar.
It's kind of got like these primal motifs.
Wild. That's right. Yeah.
So we'll get there.
Well, I didn't put that on there.
Oh, you didn't put that on there?
I forgot about that.
Well, then, okay. Was that announced at Paris Games Week?
It was, they actually showed gameplay. It wasn't just like a cinematic.
Is that the one where you're riding a bear? Because that's the only...
Wild?
Yeah, yeah. I think that's the only 15-second clip that I saw was just him running up to a bear, not fighting it, and it just looked like it was a wild bear. You just run up to it, and then you mount the bear.
Yeah, he called it. He called it, and the bear came.
Oh, you mount the bear guy.
So he's like a shaman or something, because at one point he like... Either he turns into a bird or like...
No, he took control of a bird.
Okay.
That's like the main thing about this game is you could control the animals that do your bidding.
That sounds pretty sweet.
So
it
like,
doesn't sound very wild at all, actually.
Living the druid life?
Yeah. So he like controlled a bunny to like interrupt like a ceremony, like a bunch of crows. So the crows got up and then he took control of the crows and made the crows attack the savages. It was pretty interesting.
Sounds like there's a lot of opportunity for like creativity in how you execute things.
Yeah, that's what it looked like.
And then at the end, they summon a giant snake lady or something. It was really weird.
Like
snake lady?
Yeah, I kind of missed that introduction, so I'm like,
how did this happen?
So like,
how did we get here?
Yeah, exactly. It was really confusing for me. So it's you're trying to save someone who got bit by a snake. So it looks like you're talking to the snake god. And you had to do something for her. It's like, oh, do you want to do this? Do you know what happened if you do this?
Are we talking like giant for a snake? So is it like 2 feet tall?
No. It's a giant snake lady.
Yeah.
Like it's
enormous.
Huge.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool.
I mean, the graphics didn't look that good. But yeah. It was like, it didn't look like, you know, like Far Cry Primal or something like that.
Yeah, it's very indie for sure.
Yeah. So it looks interesting. I like the concept. We'll see how that one pans out.
Yeah, I got a thing for Snake Weighty, so I don't know. I'm interested.
Next is the Uncharted 4 multiplayer was shown, which doesn't sound as like generic as you think because they added a bunch of weird stuff to it.
Yeah,
you mean it's not as generic as it sounds?
Yeah, because it's like, oh, it's just Uncharted multiplayer. It's like, no, it's completely different now.
Gotcha.
Well, because they, first of all, like if you've seen any of the gameplay demos, like the one where they introduced it, where he like, you know, slides down that cliff and jumps off it and like hits the guy and stuff.
Yeah.
Like seems like there's like a lot of traversal options. But also they throw a lot of the weird supernatural stuff in the game. Like at one point somebody has this like ancient relic and she throws it and this giant like totem pops up and starts like sending fire all over the place or whatever.
Yeah. It's kind of crazy. Like Elena had like this like fire aura and she like teleported away.
Is that a common theme in Uncharted? Because you know I haven't played that much. Is like the supernatural?
It's
and
not
like
near the end of the game. Some of the games start getting a little supernatural. Yeah,
for sure. But it's not,
we're talking a little bit like Indiana Jones.
Kind of like Tomb Raider style.
Yeah.
Kind of. Sure. Like at the end, there's a big old dragon, even though it's like pretty much a realistic game.
Yeah.
Okay. They also have something called like assist characters. I don't know how this is going to work in multiplayer.
Yeah, me either.
But you like have people like assisting you, like AI, I guess. I have no idea what it is. Like you summon someone to like help you snipe someone or someone to give you ammo and stuff like that. It's
got to be AI because it would be too.
Do they jump in outside of the screen and like give you something and then leave?
I have
or
no
they,
idea.
Like,
it wasn't explained very well.
It was just shown like these, like you know, you usually play as the characters, the main characters of the game. So you have these generic, like mercenary-looking guys come in and help you.
Well, the mystery of not knowing is kind of titillating, right?
Yeah, I want to play it, and obviously we're going to be able to play it in December and at PSX. So
I did hear that the multiplayer was received super well, though. So regardless of what weird stuff happens, I guess it's good.
Yeah.
Well, you had said their multiplayer has always been good, right?
Yeah, I played a lot of the Uncharted 3 multiplayer. Like Grayson, my roommate, he still plays The Last of Us multiplayer. That game came out like 2 years ago.
They're really similar.
No, they're not. Last of Us is very like tactile, like taking your time, like spending stuff crafting, and Uncharted just like climbing stuff, jumping off stuff. Like that's way more actiony.
So it's like the quintessential action game, right?
You would say.
Okay.
But it's in third person, so that's what kind of sets it apart from like Call of Duty or whatever.
You played Ratchet and Clank, right? No, Connor.
Oh, hell yeah, I love Ratchet and Clank.
So imagine stuff like that, like the shooting, like, you know, you're running around jumping everywhere and then you like target someone on the ground and you start shooting them.
Right, gotcha.
Very action-y like that. I still remember, this reminds me of when they showed the Uncharted 2 multiplayer demo.
Oh, yeah, because 1 didn't have multiplayer.
Yeah, and it was like, the trailer was all set up like it was like a first person, like a story-driven mission, and then like it pans out, and suddenly the HUD pops up, and it's multiplayer, and you see all the player names everywhere, and it's like, holy crap, this is a multiplayer game?
Nice.
Oh, yeah. It looked, I remember.
So just like the footage you were seeing, like, got you pretty pumped, like, on the spot.
Yeah, because it looked really cool.
Reminds me of The Division.
Yeah, exactly.
It looks like a four-player co-op game, and it's awesome, and then it just zooms out, and you see there's, like, so many other people, and you're like, oh.
Yeah. That sounds,
Or what was the other one? Was that Watch Dogs that they did the same thing? There's a whole single-player demo, and then, like,
Yeah,
and then it like kind of pans over and starts following some other random character, and they're doing something, and then you start hearing people talk to other characters, and you're like, what? And then the player names pop up, and you're like, oh, wait, what? These more people?
And dude, then it came out.
It's always such...
Yeah, exactly. And then the release date approached.
Such hype. Like, whenever they
they're good at doing that.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of hype real quick, something just crossed my mind.
Yeah.
What if the FF7 remake has multiplayer?
What?
I don't know how that would work, like online chocobo races or something like that.
Whoa, dude, that like, sounds sick. I'm not going to lie.
Actually, think about that. Well, you could actually have like arena mode type things where you,
right,
you,
or
know,
just,
you, you yeah. have your party, right? And then it'll automatically be leveled up or down to 50. I don't know what the scale is.
Yeah,
you know,
I love that system. They started doing it in WoW too.
Yeah, and then you fight against other players' parties. Like, it's turn-based.
I'm sure they'll think of something. We don't know if it's turn-based yet.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah,
but,
true.
But like, I don't know. That could actually kind of work. It would be weird, though.
Yeah, that could be a whole episode just talking about multiplayer FF7.
You're talking about FF7, and you're just making me hope there's FF7 at PSX.
Oh, I know. Because that's where they originally trolled us.
Yeah. I'm not trying to get everyone all fired up here.
Another Warcraft 4 moment right there.
Dude.
No, they'll troll us again at
don't
PSX.
Do me like
they'll
that.
Say that there's, they'll say that there's you know, online capabilities and all that, and people are going to get so freaking pumped.
And it's leaderboards.
Yeah, leaderboards. And it's just like, come on!
The ultimate bait and switch.
Awful.
Hook, line, and sinker, dude.
Final Fantasy Remake online.
Oh man. What? Well, hey, let's keep going down the game. Sorry, yeah, I knew I was gonna screw up our flow with
all
that
right,
one.
All right, so I don't think was this announced at Paris Games Week or after, but they showed footage of the new Nier game.
Yeah, I wasn't at the conference. They got showed like the day after.
Yeah.
So I'm excited. I, you know, there's this like weird, like it has a super cult following for this game called Nier. I've never played it, but like a lot of people I follow like on Twitter and online talk about it. It's like it was this action RPG from Square Enix last gen that like not a lot of people played. And they announced this like sequel out of nowhere at E3, and it's being developed by Platinum Games.
It looks like a Platinum game again.
And but like Square Enix is doing like the story, and like I guess the composer is like really renowned, and like they has a good soundtrack. Yeah, and it looks like a Platinum game. It's you're this like android girl, I guess. They reveal you're an android, and she's slicing up these robots that look like the robots from Castle in the Sky, if you've ever seen that.
Oh, yeah.
Those kind of big, huge ones. Yeah, they look very similar to that. But it's in this really cool, like, lush green environment. So definitely look that up. It's called Nier Automata is, like, the subtitle.
And the Nier is spelled N-I-E-R?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just for clarification.
I just know the music for that trailer. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
It's pretty great.
It's, like, very tribal in a way.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. So, yeah.
It's good.
Definitely go look that up. I think it's a PS4 exclusive, too.
Yeah, it is a PS4. So, they announced it at E3.
Well, good for them.
Yeah. So I'm excited. I know nothing about Nier, but I want to play that game. It looks neat.
Yeah.
Sounds interesting.
All right.
What else we got?
PlayStation VR was shown again. They showed
a little bit,
They showed the mech game again.
Rigs.
Which looks interesting. I want to play it at PSX again.
Big robots.
Yeah, big robots again.
I still don't know. I think it's going to be a launch title. It's going to be something that's just...
You don't know.
Think it'll just be totally vanilla?
I think it's just going to be terrible. Like,
vanilla.
So
bad.
So many launch games look cool and then are not at all. Like, I mean, and it's unfortunate. But it's
and
just,
the hype of the launch totally enhances that too.
Yeah.
It's like,
so like, I mean, I hope it gets sales. I mean, I'm glad that people do those kinds of games, but it's like until you know what people even like about the system. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's you're not going to have a control.
There's
going to
be a lot of experimentation with VR.
Yeah.
Like, there's going to be like I've seen games, some VR games that are in third person. I'm like, that makes no sense. The whole point of VR is to be first person.
Yeah,
right?
Like
so I don't know what they're trying with
like
that.
First
but.
Person horror games would be good on it.
Oh,
racing
man.
Games and like simulation games would be good on it.
Then again, you know, look back to when people are starting to look at home consoles, right? And then let's say they hear about the new Metal Gear Solid 4, and they're like, yeah, the whole game, you barely control the character. And they're like, well, what's the point of having a controller? Why not just watch a movie then?
Yeah.
Like, so, I mean, there's always going to be a niche for even the things that don't initially seem like it's the whole point.
Right.
I'm sure somebody will do something clever. So.
Well, yeah, there's tons of different ways to use VR, too, and like ways that have, of course, not even been explored yet. A really interesting thing I saw, pardon me, is that they for the first Warriors game of the NBA season, I know there's not many sports fans probably follow, but there was an option where you could watch the Warriors game through VR like technology if you had it. And like, so I guess the concept is like you're courtside and you can like look around to the left and right.
Oh, so there's like a camera in one of the seats or something?
Yeah,
I guess?
Something like that.
Oh, wow,
I just
that's
thought it was
neat.
Thought it was really interesting. It showed some people using it and like they didn't really give a good feel of like how the experience was, but if you can kind of picture what it would be like to be, like be standing on the sideline and like have freedom to look whichever way, it's like I don't know. There's some ways where that kind of technology could be like utilized in really interesting ways.
I think that's really where VR is going to take off. It's like buy a virtual ticket to a concert. So
yeah,
you like,
exactly.
You put on headphones. You put on VR. Yeah. I think that a lot of that stuff is kind of what VR is going to be about.
I wonder then how much that's going to be pirated. You could just literally like torrent a concert.
Yeah, right.
I mean,
exactly.
Like, it's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. It's definitely a brave new world as far as like this like. New technology that's coming out. It's like kind of unlike anything we've really seen before.
Like concert attendance drops because of this? Like,
yeah.
That's so weird.
It could be.
Yeah, that would be ridiculous if it got to that
point. Evolution
of
streaming. Like you're streaming a concert or you're streaming a sports event.
Can you imagine if someone got that for their couch? So literally like popular streamers could have one of those cameras right next to them so you could act like you're just chilling on the couch
right.
with them. So you could look over and see their expressions. You could look over at the TV and watch and
yeah.
like chill. You could look down at the popcorn and salivate. Yeah. Like,
chill with Taylor.
Yo,
right?
Pass me some of that popcorn, bro.
And he just chucks it at the camera and like...
Oh, tasty.
Like depending on the cost of that stuff, like I might... Give that a try, like
right.
the concert or like going, like you said, going like a Warriors game.
Oh, dude, well, like, I would freak out if I could like stand,
honestly,
essentially sideline.
I'm actually thinking I'm gonna jump pretty hard onto the VR stuff. So
oh,
like,
okay.
Once it comes out,
go
like,
for broke.
So, yeah, I'd like to try out a few different ones, and it's gonna be expensive as hell. But I would like to jump in that just so that I can
say you were there.
Exactly. It's like that's kind of what my philosophy with the Xbox One was and, mm-hmm. and the PS4. The reason I ended up getting both, even though it was really expensive at the time, it was like. Regardless of the problems they may have and regardless of, you know, which one's better or if they're terrible or whatever, it's like I want to just be able to be there and be able to, mm-hmm. I can say, yeah,
gave it a
terrible.
College try.
Exactly. I was
yeah.
there.
Yeah, it's something
from the
about it. It's like
yeah.
there's something to say about, especially being part of the industry, you know, which we are, you know.
Uh-huh.
There's
yeah, of course.
Little, it's like as minor as we are, it's like there's that bit of, I feel like it's kind of, I should be there, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
So,
totally.
I don't know.
Especially like, I mean, for like the purposes of like, LHG too. It'd be great
yeah.
to have your perspective on
yeah.
that. So that'd be exciting.
My but, full perspective.
Yeah. Oh, dude, could you imagine the VR possibilities with like, let's say, adult entertainment?
I'm
I mean,
sure.
let's not go down that conversation.
It's
but
well, I think that sort of thing has already happened.
Yeah, I'll just say technology is a terrifying thing.
That was in a movie. That was in Gamer.
Was it? Is that?
Do you remember that movie?
It sounds like a movie concept.
With what's his name? The guy from 300.
Gerald Butler.
Oh yeah,
Gerald
falls,
Butler?
He falls
yeah.
in love with the virtual girl of his dreams and like forsakes his like
no,
real
no,
life
no.
or
he
something.
Becomes a he. It's actually pretty cool. Out.
Very,
we should
very brief.
Do this later.
Yeah. Yeah.
Go watch Gamer.
Never mind.
Go watch Gamer. It's
never
pretty,
mind.
It's pretty interesting. It's not like the best movie, but it's got some interesting stuff. So,
but once again, at least you're going to be able to try it at VSX.
Oh yes, right.
I
yes.
bet they're gonna announce the release date and the price. At
they
PSX.
Better. Oh god, I hope it's like
people need to know, man.
$150.
I guarantee it'll be $300. That's my. That's what I'm thinking. It's
that's
be.
Not bad. I'd actually. I'd be happy
because they said I was reading some interviews and they said they're treating it like a console launch.
They
it's,
should.
Okay.
But
well, then $400.
Yeah. Well, seriously, I was actually expecting $600. Yeah. If I had to make a guess, because
I feel like that's realistic.
Hugely, yeah. That seems like I'm buying a VR headset that's. Really good, apparently. Mm. I mean, like
it's like
know.
A prototypical technology.
Yeah,
it's like
I,
first.
I would say the 600s
Raider Rocket League VR.
Oh, dude! I would get nauseous real quick. Yeah.
I was actually thinking, Grow Home. If you guys remember, I streamed that game a little while ago. That would actually just be fun. It would. I feel like it would be easy to implement VR stuff because it's such a simple game,
mm-hmm.
and it would be fun. It was like you know, I would totally pay. Another $15 to rebuy that game on one of the VR consoles just because it would just be, I don't know, just fun to play.
Yeah.
They announced a Until Dawn VR game.
Yeah, it's some weird, like,
it's like a
rail shooter
yeah.
or whatever. It has nothing to do with the main game.
Okay.
It's just for spooks.
Sure.
Although, yeah, I guess VR should be very interesting. We're all excited.
Yeah, we should. Wonder how that's going to pan out. If it's going to be another move or it's going to be actually hit.
I mean, they're investing a lot into this. I can't imagine it'll be like a 2-year thing that just fizzles out. Like,
right.
Well, I saw them.
They'll try to get your turn.
I saw something. They totally messed up with that.
What's a Vita?
They showed some cool things with the VR. It's not really a game, but it's called, like, it was promoting this movie called The Walk.
Oh, yeah. Where this guy, apparently, like, this French dude a while ago. set up a tightrope between the two towers when they were still standing.
Oh, yeah.
And he, like, walks across it or something. And this VR experience is if you're the guy walking across it or whatever.
Dude. I just kind of got a little vertigo when you said that.
Yeah, that's exactly what people are doing.
So they would need to do, like, it would need to be, like, 4K, though, honestly. Because I feel like if I'm looking at, if I were pretending to be there, right? If I'm, like, seeing that.
It would have to be realistic.
It would have to be, like, extremely good resolution. And I honestly don't know if 1080 would cut it.
1080 is not even on the 1080 is not even the VR headset. It's like lower than 720.
No.
Yeah.
Lower than 720.
Well, dude, you got to think of like the volume of the amount of graphics that it's trying to process, like to basically run and it like entire virtual reality.
It's not 1080. I could tell you that.
Oh, that's too bad.
We'll look into that. We'll look into that. We'll confirm or deny.
Bloodworth from GT said that it doesn't look HD. Because that's how they
start, you know, it's a start. But either way, any other games I was wondering from
Move on.
Yeah, VR is a really interesting topic, but there's a ton of stuff on here. I just want to make sure we have time for it all.
So I'm going to save the big discussion last. But there was this game called Boundless that was announced.
Yeah, that was very confusing.
It was No Man's Sky Minecraft.
Yeah, you're like these weird little alien guys, and you were like walking in and out of these portals, but the world was very like voxely, like a Minecraft world. Like I didn't really understand what was going on.
Yeah, and you could build like machines and everything like that. And
adult Minecraft,
so
maybe.
Tired of this.
No, but it's like
you got to expect for anything that makes that much money, there's going to be hordes of imitators.
Yeah, it's but like, it's like what's it called?
No Man's Sky.
No Man's Sky, because every world, like, it's always procedurally online. So every world is explored. It's a new one that anyone could find.
Yeah. I mean, we'll see.
Every world is different.
What I don't like is that I feel like the pitch for this game was literally what you just told us. It was like, why don't we just take Minecraft and add one of the most popular features from No Man's Sky?
Yeah, it's like a cash cow waiting to be killed.
Yeah, like it's frustrating just even hearing that in my head, even hearing that pitch and hearing people go like, "Well, yeah, let's develop this game." Well,
yeah, it's crazy. They're circling around the money pinata and putting on their blindfolds right now for sure.
But the thing is, there hasn't been a very good Minecraft clone, and Minecraft could be way better than it is right now.
Terraria is arguably a good Minecraft clone, if
but
you want to call
2D.
It.
But it's 2D.
Yeah.
I
wouldn't call it a Minecraft clone.
It's more limited.
Inspired. Yeah. But definitely not a clone. Yeah. I mean, you can look. There are literally hundreds on like the, you know, Xbox 360
App Store.
Marketplace.
Oh my
the App
God,
Store
yeah.
is horrific.
Yeah, inundated.
I mean, and Flappy Bird. There are literally over 1,000 games that are parodies of Flappy Bird.
And this is why mobile games
1,000.
Are not good.
No, that is not why. That is not even.
It's
close.
Just oversaturated. There are good mobile games. It's just the ratio of good to bad is
too many copycats.
Worse, the ratio is worse than it should be.
Well, it's not like an official market or anything. It's like there's plenty of copycats for mobile game or for console games too. It's just that no one ever hears about them because they can't really get out there.
Yeah.
With the App Store, you just need to like apply, get it approved, and then it's out there.
And you're on the front page. Yeah. But it's a new app. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's not like it's. You know, it's just more public. That's all.
Gotcha.
So okay.
That's cool.
Enough about that.
I want to see more of it. So let's see how that turns out. Mm. Gran Turismo Sport was announced. So a new racing Gran Turismo game. That's not us.
I see a new subtitle on it. What exactly does that entail? What are they saying is different about it?
I didn't even know. It was like it was super.
I think
boring.
It was. So part of it was like I think you can sort of. It's Drive Club esque. That.
Yeah. Okay. I remember they were. So it's all about like sports cars and racing now. So they're not like all cars.
Wait,
because Gran Turismo. Wait a minute. Because Gran Turismo 6 and 5 was like everything cars.
Like you drive like go shitty Hondas and stuff.
Like,
yeah,
they're focusing.
You gotta go. You're driving a wheat thresher.
Yeah, something like they do weird stuff like that. This one's focusing on like you know racing and sports cars and stuff like that.
Gotcha.
And
kind of back VR
back
compatibility.
To the and VR compatible.
Okay.
But the cool thing is if you because racing is. A big thing. You could actually win official racing trophies for racing in this game. Like you actually get an official, I forgot what it's called, like a TIA or whatever. Some racing organization.
Oh yeah, they like partner with some like racing corporation or whatever. Yeah.
So they're mailing people physical trophies is what you're saying.
Yeah, I think so. You could actually, since if you're a really good professional Gran Turismo racer, which there are people like that, you could win an official trophies and you could be like known. to win. That's pretty
sweet. That would be cool.
You'll be recognized as like an official racer.
It's an interesting gimmick that I've never really heard of before, and for that, I kind of have to commend them.
Yeah, it's really interesting.
It is interesting that they didn't call it Gran Turismo 7. They just called it. They gave it a subtitle.
Right.
So I'm
curious.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. It better be real different.
Yeah.
Well, I think they're trying to do that whole reboot thing. I mean, especially if you look at their main competitor, Forza. I mean, it's like it's not just new numbers for Forza. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, they're going with Horizon and they're getting success there.
So. It's like a reboot light.
And the last, kind of, Gran Turismo. I don't. A lot of people don't know this, but like of all the first party studios like that Sony owns, Gran Turismo is the biggest PlayStation franchise. Bigger than like Uncharted or anything. Like it sells like crazy.
Yeah, I've heard that before, and I remember being surprised. I'm like, wow, really? It's like one of their front runners.
Europe eats that stuff up. They love like adding peripherals, like the steering wheel and all that crap. So,
And good news, because everyone knows what happened to Gran Turismo 5. It's coming out next year.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. Any specifics on that? Or
they said there's a beta early in 2016.
Yeah, so you're going to actually be able to play it next year. So you don't have to wait another 6 years to play it.
Well, that's cool. My engine's revved. Sounds good, dude. Yeah, I know. I'm sorry.
I like that. I like that. We could have just left it alone.
Yeah, you can't win them all, guys. That's just a lesson in the numbers game that is
can't
life.
Can't come in first place every time.
I love it. Sorry, in Talladega Nights, he's like, you know, he always says, if you're not first, you're last. And he says to his dad, he's like, Dad, you told me if you're not first, you're last. What happened to that? And he's like, I must have been drunk or something. Yeah. That's ridiculous. I mean, you can come in second, third, fourth. That doesn't even make any sense.
I lose my life around that.
If you're not first, you're anything else. Anyways.
Jake really wants to talk about this one.
I actually want to talk about this,
they
too.
They announced the people who made
next
Evely
game
Ray.
From, don't say it. Don't say it. Kara, 2012 tech demo. From
Quantic Dream.
There you go.
They made this little tech demo to show off. It was a graphics processor, was it? Or
something like
something?
That.
They do this all the time.
Yeah, and that's Quantic Dream is known for these things. I believe at it was at when they announced the PS4, 3 years ago. They had this old man.
Guy.
Yeah, this like sorcerer kind of guy. And
so that's
going to
be the
rendered.
Next game in about 3 years.
Yeah.
Well, I gotta say, I'm really glad they didn't do that because like I heard that they were probably going to announce their game at Paris Games League, like, oh, that sorcerer, but the goblin just looks so dumb. Like, I hope that's not it.
Yeah. So Kara, it was pretty much, they turned it into a short film. They you could tell it became a passion project, like, halfway through this. You know, they just started loving it. So it was all about this android. Android's correct? It's a robot that is in the shape of a person. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yeah. Sounds
right. Android. They call it an android in the presentation.
So,
yeah.
So an android is being built, right? And then she's standing there. And she's being interviewed by, it seems like quality control guy, something like that. And he's asking her these like, you know, questions, making sure she's
three plus three is
exactly like, you know, regular things. And then it gets a little bit like, I can't, it's been so long since I've watched it, but it got a little bit like, you know, do you know who you are or where are you or why are you here?
Yeah, she becomes relevant.
Self-aware.
So she starts like asking these questions that you can tell he's a little disturbed by. And I think at some point, like he goes to the activator. I could be totally making parts of this up in my head because it's been a while. But like, I thought,
whatever you're making up sounds cool.
He went to like deactivator.
He was going to deactivator.
And then he like had some compassion or something. He started feeling really bad about it because she didn't want that.
Moral conflict.
Yeah. So then he's like, you know what? Fine. And then just said it was fine. Like pretty much cleared her. Right. And then she gets packed up and then like almost like in a like a box kind of thing like you would buy. And then she's shipped out. And
that was a short film.
And that was it. That was the whole short film. But it was, you know, the graphics were really nice. I mean, it was still 2012, you know. And
sounds like a really interesting concept.
Yeah, but it was just the acting for it and everything. It was a very emotional thing. And I fell in love with that short. So I
just laughed because he used the word emotions a lot in his presentation. Yeah. Sorry, go on. Yeah. In case you were wondering why I was laughing.
I didn't
it's like, what are the themes of this game? Yeah. Could you please tell me more? Yeah. Say it one more time.
So I'm really stoked because I was, you know, scrolling through like Facebook a few days ago and I just see this whole thing, you know, it's like, I see Detroit, something like that. And I'm like, okay, you know, just skimming past it. Right. And then I see Quantic Dream and I'm like, why is that familiar? I'm like, wait, they did the Kara thing a while ago. And then I keep reading and it says, this whole game, they decided to make it based off of their critically acclaimed short film Kara. And I'm like, yes. They show it's this whole beautiful cinematic trailer. And it's about, the whole thing is narrated by Kara and she is,
oh, wow.
Yeah. And so it's like, it's showing this, you know, future where there are humans, and then there are things that look exactly like humans, but they have these little tiny nodes right on their temples, and that's how you know they're an android.
Okay.
And so it's being narrated by her talking, you know, and it's kind of a, I don't want to say it's not bad, but it is a little generic, talking about, you know, like the differences between humanity and us. And
yeah,
all this stuff.
Exactly.
And talking about, you know, like what is, you know, real life.
Are we really people?
It was very corny.
But I was mainly paying attention to the graphics, and I was loving, you know, falling in love with the story, and it was written well. It wasn't bad. It was just, you know, it's that kind of
treaded ground, as it were.
And then you just see her walking along, and you see all these androids, and you see them like posed by, you know, on the sidewalk, and they're like doing different things, and it's like, obviously it's almost like an ad, but it's real androids standing in these displays, and then they're kind of like staring at her as she passes, and humans start like staring at her a little bit too, and you see it's because she has one of those little nodes.
Like, she is not a part of like what the normal android click of like, oh, you like stand in line, get in line.
She's something else.
Yeah, she's just walking along the sidewalk, just looking like a human, but you can see one little node on her temple, and it's
interesting.
Is it like
a dystopian future, or does it seem like
sort of? No, it's not dystopian.
It's a realistic future in which androids are common appliances.
Gotcha. Only in Detroit. Detroit is the place making these. That's what
Detroit will be relevant again. Sweet.
Yeah, that's what this whole thing's about.
My heart goes out to Detroit. Hard times, but
yeah. But yeah, so it's just a very, very interesting thing. And again, I think I wouldn't be as interested if I didn't already see what they could do,
right,
and what these people obviously cared about so much, and how, you know, how well it came out in the end.
How long is the short film?
It's just a few minutes.
Like five tops,
yeah,
maybe?
Oh, yeah, okay. So, like, yeah, I
yeah,
see.
I mean, it really is just, it was just a tech demo. It was just to show off how good these graphics can be.
Gotcha.
PS3. Yeah.
Roger that.
But anyway, point is, honestly, huge recommendation. Watch Kara, and then if you're interested in that, watch the trailer for the new game Detroit.
So I have a question.
Sir, yes, sir.
Have you played Heavy Rain and or Beyond Two Souls?
Absolutely not.
Neither?
I want to so bad, okay, because those seem like games that would be right up my alley. But so, I don't
Casey speaks highly of Heavy Rain.
I got some good news for
What's
you.
Up?
There's been trophies leaked that they're going to do like a collection for PS4. So those are inevitable. Those are coming at some point.
Nice.
It's just like, I think once, you know, Detroit gets a release date, then they're probably going to put that collection out.
Were those also by Quantic Dream?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, well then, perfect. Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
I'm honestly
like, Heavy Rain was good.
That was the critical darling. Yeah, I think a lot of people liked that one.
Beyond Two Souls was not.
Honestly, Beyond Two Souls looked way better than Heavy Rain did before it came out. Like, I got really stoked.
It was
Beyond Two Souls.
That's what a lot of people did, but I heard that it was just,
it got really,
it wasn't that good.
The better it looks, the higher expectations are, and then that makes the fall back to earth hurt a little more if it doesn't meet those expectations.
I will be honest, Quantic Dream could end up being one of my favorite game developers. I just have, it's that feeling where it's like, even though I've never played it,
unquantifiable,
you know,
feeling.
You can just, I just see, and every time I see it, every time I see little bits of gameplay, I'm like, these dudes, so it's like them and Ubisoft Montreal. Like, I like those two.
So you really like just visual novels?
Yeah, I actually really do. Another game which we don't have time to talk about, but I talked about it a few months ago, was Lifeline, I think, on my phone. And then they actually came out with Lifeline 2, and I just beat that.
Oh,
one.
You mean the one where you talk to the person?
Yeah, where you're not playing as a person. You're literally playing as someone they're talking to on your phone. So it's kind of, they almost break the fourth wall a bit. But it's fun.
I think these style of games are like coming into vogue in a way, because like Until Dawn just came out, and it's very similar. Like, you're just sort of walking around, making choices, like QTE type gameplay. Uh-huh. But it's like really interesting because the story's good, and
I'm a fan of the kind of prominence of like those cerebral types of games, you know, coming to be more popular, because it's like, it's almost like a pushback against like the hyper like sensory, like stimulating like shooters that are just explosions everywhere and constant like, you know, nerve overloading.
Yeah.
Well, it's that, and it's like Wayne kind of thing.
That's
gameplay. That word became so important, and now it's like it's pulling back a bit for
into experience,
for story. Yeah, experience, exactly.
That's
art.
That's why
I totally back that.
Yeah, that's why Heavy Rain was better than Beyond Two Souls, because Beyond Two Souls was just go through anything, like none of your choices mattered.
In
Heavy Rain, your choices matter.
Tons of endings.
And yeah, that's why Until Dawn was good, because you actually were doing stuff.
Well, the same with Walking Dead Season 1, for instance.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. Yep, yep.
And Beyond Two Souls didn't do that as much as well.
Sure.
So let's hope Kara, or Detroit, goes back to the Heavy Rain stuff.
So it also has a subtitle, Become Human. It's like Detroit, Become Human.
That's so generic.
I know it is. I thought it was funny. Like, I wrote a little tweet. I wrote, Detroit, comma, become human. So anyway.
Yeah. Silly guy.
I like the concept, but it's been done before, so hopefully they mix it up a little
bit. It's all about execution.
Yes. Right. They got to have something interesting in there.
So let's... Can't wait to see more of that.
Mm-hmm. So does that do it for Paris Games Week?
Oh, man. I was going to say something else about Paris Games Week, and I totally forgot.
Is it Paris Games Week or show?
It's week.
Whatever.
Oh. They call it that. I don't think it was all week.
Paris yeah. Games thing.
But, yeah, that was good. If I remember what I was going to talk about before, we'll go back. I'll go back to that. But let's go to some news that just happened, or recently.
Breaking news.
Not breaking news. But PlayStation 4, or Sony, has released a new survey asking what we would want... What new features we would want on PS4?
Lasers.
yes, lasers. And the selections include notifications when friends come online, filtering options for your games, so you could, like, you know, instead of, like...
Put them in little folders or whatever, like action games or whatever.
Oh, that's cool.
PS1 and PS2 classics.
Obviously.
Yeah. Yeah.
Able to download avatars on PS4 because for some reason we can't, even though we can on PS3.
That's very weird.
Yeah. That just seems like a weird like nuts and bolts problem. It's just like it's really needs weird. To be worked out.
Download avatars?
You know how I have a super like a
I have Mega Man
and I have a Silent Hill avatar?
Yeah, I was always wondering how you guys got those.
You were able to download them
back on
PS3.
Oh, you Oh, yeah, then
that's,
yes.
That's the only
it's
way.
Stupid.
Because I would really like to get some...
Yeah, it's so sick. I have Mega Man Robot. I have Mega Man Legends as my avatar, and like it always makes me so pumped. Like it's such an epic picture of M2's looking into the distance. Yeah.
It
like,
is.
Stoically.
Like, your account is saved on my PS4, so every time I boot up my PS4, I see my little stupid robot and then Mega Man.
Well, who's cooler?
Exactly.
But yeah, your avatar is usually just your Facebook profile.
I think it's you and your Gam-Gam. Is that your grandma? That picture?
Yeah, which is weird because that was like a super old profile picture of mine.
Maybe it just takes it from your profile the first time you like log on or something.
That's it. But
she looks like a charming lady, by the way.
Folders. Okay. The next one.
Mm-hmm. Wait, I thought that was the same one.
No, it's like filtering, like, you know, certain
similar
like,
but different.
Yeah, like adding folders like automatically and then like filtering by genre or by like name or by company, stuff like that. Custom backgrounds, which. Like, isn't it
a theme?
That's a theme thing. Now you could, like, actually customize
it. Oh, like, upload your own pictures.
Yes.
That's cool. I would like to do.
I just want better dynamic themes. There's so few that have, like, I want, like, you know, nice pictures, nice, like, interaction, you know, when you go, like, from the top to the bottom. You know, don't just make the image shift a little bit. You know, like, make it cool.
Yeah,
want to be able to make my own, like they did for the PS3 and PSP.
Yeah, you had a fireplace or something, right?
Yeah. I had rain once, and then I had a fireplace.
That's cool.
I think I would just have a picture of my favorite basketball player dunking on someone's face.
There you go.
So it'll just make me smile every time I look at the background.
Store wish list.
Cool. So,
yeah,
I like that.
Yeah, I mean, that's simple feature. Like, they could have lifted
they just,
that.
Why are they asking people, just do this?
This is probably everything they're planning on doing, and they just want to see what they want to put out first.
I guess they're probably so tired of, like, getting ripped for, like, every new thing they do, they're like, test the waters first, so people don't
flip out. PS1 and PS2 classics, it's like a no-duh.
Yeah, exactly.
I really want those back.
Same with, like, wish lists. Like, what online store, like, doesn't have a wish list?
Exactly.
It's like, you're, like, 6 years behind on this one.
Appear offline mode.
Yes, I want that. I just want to be like, sometimes you'll just bother me. Mm-hmm. I'm like, don't invite me to your stupid game. I just want to play and don't be bothered.
And another feature of that is it should disable all notifications that you get in game about other people playing. You know, like, oh, so-and-so joined a party. Like, 90% of the time, like, I couldn't give a crap
less. What about, like, maybe a do not disturb mode?
Yeah, that's like that. Same idea. Yeah, I think you're able to you could turn off certain notifications. Got I'm not 100% on that.
Well, you already can.
Right. I don't know. It's just a matter of digging around in options, which is something that is never appealing.
No, never.
This is not really for us, but an increased max party size.
Yeah.
So you could have more than 8.
Why isn't it for you?
Because we never have more than like
five people maybe.
You don't. Yeah.
Shut up, Jake.
I'm confident.
I got to beat these guys off of the stick. Oh, geez, that sentence just came out wrong. Moving on.
Hide and remove items from the library. So you know how if you go into your library, you see all these things that you downloaded a long time ago,
or
you're
like you
I don't
sold
have this
game.
Anymore.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, dude, that's
or, like,
those
you
are the worst.
A demo that you hate.
Yeah, like, and it's always there.
Yeah,
you know,
just
or
like
you,
just
or
like
you,
a burn mark, like from like when it just
or
ruined
you download
your life.
Or Onigiri because you see it's free and then you realize what it is and you're like, no, no, no.
Get out of my system.
So that, and here's the big, about that. Here's the big one.
Changing your PSN name.
Change PSN name.
Dude.
Yep.
You're kidding me.
I could maybe get my...
Because my PSN name is literally a band that's been broken up for 5 years.
Yeah, people like, this is like a constant complaint, like on one of the, on these PlayStation podcasts that me and Nick follow, like that's like their chief complaint every week is like, let us change our effing names. Cause, like
that's another nuts and bolts thing where it's like, doesn't it feel like it should be an incredibly simple thing
does,
to fix?
It does sound simple, well, but it probably isn't.
There's got to be some kind of like software blockade or like problem that's just like makes the process of fixing that really like more complicated than it should be.
Yeah,
somebody brought up a good point. Like instead of like actually changing like the name and the code, like change like what it's displayed as.
Yeah, exactly.
Something
that'd
like
be
that.
An easy kind of band-aid fix.
It's, yeah, it's just like covering it up
type like of thing. Like Steam.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. Street Fighter V did that, which was interesting.
Oh yeah, yeah. You're like dim, like LHG dimless or something. Yeah, or whatever. Yeah.
So
it'd
like,
be sweet if we could all have LHG in our PSN names.
Yeah, yeah. Taylor
so,
dash LHG
yeah, so
or whatever.
Like,
yeah,
my name was Dimless 2003 as my PSN name, and I was able to change it to whatever I want to LHG dim, and then that's what I did.
Nice. You know? Sweet,
cool. Sounds like some fun changes.
Yeah,
if they happen,
I think those might all be coming for a PSX, like for the hardcore PlayStation they people. Better. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, I think that's what they're saving that for.
Cool, gotcha. PS,
if they announce backwards compatibility emulation for all our old games,
that'd be cool.
Don't get ahead of yourself, though.
I know, that'd be amazing.
Don't shoot for the stars.
I don't think it's shooting for the stars, though. Seriously, the main competition, Xbox.
Speaking of that. Xbox One backwards compatibility comes out the 12th of this month.
Mm-hmm. How does that work? Do they just like patch it into the system? No, like,
so what it's
insane.
It's
that sounds insane to me.
It's a firmware update where pretty much it's all they... Because, I mean, there's nothing like advanced about reading Xbox 360 discs. I'm not entirely sure.
It's emulation. They're emulating
it. It's not only reading it, but it's how it's using... The processors in the system, like I think it's hard on PS3 because, like on PS3, they had to sell, which was like a nightmare.
Yeah,
for developers, and so Xbox is very PC based, so it's easier to like find the components and how to route your power.
Tinker
and stuff.
With the.
And you know what's nice as well is it's gonna be like so. For instance, if you played an Xbox original game on the Xbox 360, you couldn't access any of the Xbox 360 features. So like the dashboard wouldn't work. Nothing would work. It would just you could open up the dashboard and it would just be like a basic thing that gives you the option to turn the console off.
So it's like a totally separate entity.
Menu. Yeah, it's like it really didn't like it. So this one
isn't the same thing in here. It goes you turn on the menu, but it opens a 360 menu.
No.
That's what that's what I've heard. That's what happens.
Because you boot up.
I guess
integrating
it.
Emulating.
Yeah, you boot up a 360. Yeah.
Really?
It seems like integrating it into the main thing.
Like
you're
able to play people on 360, but you're just running a 360.
How positive are you about that? Because
about 60-80%.
So I with Rare Replay, you know, they give you a bunch of Rare games, obviously, and some of those are for 360. Let's look at Banjo-Kazooie Nuts and Bolts, for example. If you boot that up, you actually it's strange. Just for the 360 titles, they actually are separate downloads onto the console. Not all of them are on the disc.
That's what it's going to be. That's going to
right.
Gonna
and
be
those,
like.
It's not an Xbox 360 menu.
No,
oh,
nice.
You press it and it'll like it comes up full screen, right? And then it goes to black, then goes to white, and it does the Xbox 360 like you know thing.
Yeah,
and you
yeah,
turn
yeah.
On the console, and then the game starts and it starts playing fine. And if you press the Xbox home button again, it just minimizes just like an Xbox One game would.
Okay,
back.
Sweet.
That's good.
That's so how it should be.
That is, you know, those are the Rare Replay ones specifically.
Yeah, so we don't know how they're
going
to run.
So maybe the backwards compatible ones are not, even though...
We don't know.
In the game's menu, though, when you're looking at the icons for them, they'll say, like, Xbox 360 on the left, so...
Right.
I mean, I don't know. It seems like that's what it would be, but...
So it's going to be, like, I don't know, it's 100 games first on the first update, and they're going to continuously add more and more to it.
And what's nice is that all the future games with gold games for 360 are going to be on that list of... compatible ones.
Oh, cool.
So from now on, you will always get 4 games for Xbox One. Two of them specifically for Xbox One, and two of them that can work.
Nice.
Which are actually for 360.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it's pretty nice. Especially that actually finally gives them the leg up on on PlayStation because normally PS4 has 3 to 4 titles. So
and that's why I'm pretty sure they're going to copy them and say, hey, we have emulation as well.
Right. They're smart
and now
enough.
It's like see all the. The games that you had for your PS3, PS2, and PS1, well, now they're all playable on PS4.
Well, I already sold them all. Sorry.
Yeah. Right?
It's exactly what people have been saying about this. They're like, I just sold all my Xbox 360 games. And I can't. It's like, well, that's your fault. Don't sell your games.
Whatever. Gotta do what you gotta do.
Sometimes you gotta.
Yep. I know.
Be sensitive to the college kids in the room.
Evo 2016 dates were finally announced today. Sunday.
Today?
Today, Sunday.
We gotta go!
All right. They're coming. They're starting on July 15th through the 17th on 2016.
Cool.
So we should start planning to go there.
Yep. Start taking your vitamins, sharpening your pencils, boys. We got work to do.
Yep. Got
trading your pennies now for those plane tickets.
Got to train a lot. It's going to be fun.
Is it?
Yeah, it is, actually. I can't wait to learn.
Well, the fun part is going to be making you an actual training montage with, like, some really great, like, 80s, like, montage music.
Oh, yeah.
Where you're, like, running on a treadmill and, playing a match with your fight stick whilst doing so, sweating furiously, and then you turn to the camera, and I turn to the camera, and we both give the thumbs up and look at each other.
I'd be entirely fine using music straight from Kung Fury.
I saw like 5 minutes of that yesterday, and I almost didn't walk away in one piece. It's so nice.
That movie's ridiculous.
It's out of control.
In like the best way possible.
It sucks. The middle gets kind of boring, but like everything else.
The end.
Oh, man. Laser Raptors.
Yeah.
I love that like grizzly voice. He's like clearly just faking the whole movie. My Dirk Bass or whatever.
Sorry. Favorite joke though in the movie, I think, is like one of the most underplayed. It's the first thing he says in the movie. He's sitting, or no, is it after his origin story? He's sitting there and he's sitting on the couch and there's a girl like, you know, on his shoulder and he's like, yeah, that's my bicep.
Yep.
And that's it. It's just like, that's it. And then the phone rings and they don't talk to it. It's just like, just to letting her know, yep, that's my bicep. Like,
sweet.
Sorry. All right.
I love that.
Let's move on.
All right. So, Halo 5. Jake.
Tell us all about it.
Tell us all about it. Are you disappointed?
Did you hunt the truth? Was the truth hunted?
No. I didn't actually watch Hunt the Truth Season 2. I just ran out of time. So, I mean, season one, I went on my whole rant about that. It's phenomenal. You should listen to it. It gives some decent insight. It's just nice lore. It's good.
Affirmative.
Okay, so because we don't have tons of time, and even if we did, I would still take it up. The two main things, obviously, campaign and multiplayer. Campaign, I've only played the first two levels of it. I played the first level, which followed Locke and his team, Fireteam Osiris, and I only really knew about Locke and Buck on the team, who was previously, he was the ODST team leader in Halo 3 ODST. So it was played and voice and face acted by Nathan Fillion, which is awesome, always a treat. And so he became really, you know, good apparently in the military, and they recruited him as a Spartan 4.
Sweet.
Okay.
And so now he's part of Fireteam Osiris, charged with hunting down Master Chief.
Question about Spartan 4s. Mm. Aren't they, like, weaker Spartans than Master Chief?
Yeah, so basic rundown of the Spartans. Spartan 1s, there were no, like, they were awesome, but, like, then the power suits had to be plugged in, and they weren't, like, as augmented. They were just kind of like, it just ended up being too much trouble. Uh-huh. So they were kind of just put back into the Marines. And then Spartan 2s were super physically and chemically augmented, and most of them washed out during that process, and they were put on the more rigorous training than anyone else has ever been on, and then they had these power suits that were super experimental, and they ended up working really well, and they became just unstoppable. And that's what Master Chief and the rest of them are. Super, uber powerful.
Affirmative.
Spartan 3s were cheaper versions of them, almost suicide mission kind of stuff, and that's what you played as in Halo Reach. And now for Halo 5, you're playing as Spartan 4s, and that's they're pretty much, they took pre-existing soldiers that were really badass, and the Spartans just kind of became an elite force, you know. But it's really just it's soldiers with all their personalities intact and everything like that who just were recruited into the Spartans, and then they got these power suits which aren't as good as Spartan dudes.
So they're badasses, but they're just regular old badasses.
They're just regular old badasses instead of like trained since they were 6
chemically
years old.
Altered destructive
exactly yeah
machines.
It's actually really frustrating. So I've only played the first two levels, and so far, I mean, obviously, they have not met. There hasn't been a huge clash or anything. You know, it's just the game's just begun. I mean, in the first level, you're not even hunting him down quite yet. It's not. I haven't gotten into the meat of the game. But it's frustrating to think that throughout the game, you know, the Spartan 4s can even match up with against one Spartan too. Because, like, you know, Master Chief or Kelly or Frederick or Linda, the, which is all Master Chief's team, should be able to just
wipe
annihilate
him out.
Them.
Yeah.
And just no competition. And it's I guess it's frustrating that it's like...
A departure from the war.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like it should be there. And, and I guess they've got armor neutralizers or something so they can...
Some kind
they
of
can
like...
technically like EMP and like deactivate their suits. But like...
It's like a convenience plot device kind of
it's
thing.
It's just... the whole thing seems a little weak. I don't know. Okay. I'm just
we'll have
not,
to give it some more time.
Yeah, and again, you know, maybe the game's like, yeah, no, they totally can't. They, well, I mean, they have.
Yeah, you might get some kind of big explanation or big reveal.
Yeah, or yeah, and maybe it'll be super good there. But point is, assuming, you know, without assuming actually anything about the rest of the campaign, the first two levels, pretty sweet. I'm still getting used to the controls for everything, and that's actually kind of moving into the multiplayer thing. Is that all the gameplay mechanics? Are just weird. They've added so much to the game.
Does it still feel Halo?
No. That's kind of a frustrating thing.
It feels like...
That's like a revelation.
Halo, Destiny, right? Yeah. It looked like Destiny
Halo
a lot of ways.
Well, Halo 4 already felt like a huge departure. Not,
for sure.
Not like so foreign, though. You know, it's like going from Mexico to Spain. You know, it's like same language, and it's like... but like... It's definitely different, you know?
Yeah.
This is going from Mexico to Japan. This is like entirely different.
Gotcha.
And it's frustrating. And so anyway, so I guess there's a humongous amount of emphasis put on like the thruster packs on their backs, which all Spartans have now, including they like retroactively put these on the Spartan 2s.
That's some advanced warfare type shit.
It's really frustrating because like in Halo 4, Master Chief just had these jets on his back. Like he's always had them. It was never explained. They're there now. It's like, oh.
Now they explained it.
And now, no, they didn't explain it. It's the same thing. So now, even the Spartan 2s, when you're playing them in the campaign, they all have these like jet moves and cool stuff. I'm like, what is this? This is new. And anyway. But
it sounds like most of the beefs are like smaller war-related stuff.
Sorry, that's with campaign. So let me, if I'm going into multiplayer, it is.
Wrap it up.
Sorry. So the multiplayer, I guess it's, since you're all Spartan 4s, you have all these different things. Like, if you jump in the air, you can, and then you aim, you'll hover in the air for a while, and you can
oh,
shoot
shit.
All day.
That's like some
not all day,
Matrix
like,
shit.
Yeah, and you'll just kind of chill there. Your jets will just hold you in place for at least, like, 5 seconds, which is obviously a long time. Then you have a thing, if you're sprinting, and you get full speed, and then you do a melee, you do, like, a shoulder charge thing, which, like, it kind of zooms out for when you do it, and it's this weird, like, jet-induced thing. You have this thing where you can jump up in the air, and if you press melee, if you hold that, then you'll hover again and you'll start targeting the ground. And I think people have been seeing this.
Target
the ground
smash.
And then you like
you
thrust down to the ground and hit the ground really hard and hit everyone around you. And
okay,
and it's just weird. And like, I feel like
so you're basically Yoshi. You just go and like down B on fools.
Yeah, and like, and so you die easier. The wreck system is. Okay.
Sounds way more fast paced with people flying around and hovering in the air and doing all kinds of crazy kung fu shit.
So then there's in multiplayer there's Warzone and Arena. In Warzone you get the wreck packs which you can spawn in vehicles and better weapons and all this stuff and it's just not
Halo.
It feels weird. It's like when you play Warzone there are no vehicles around. It's like you have to spawn them in. There's no you can't just get in one.
That is weird.
And it's random too. You can't get like a Raptor every time or whatever, right?
Well, it's so you open packs, and that's where the microtransactions come in. You can buy different packs of cards, pretty much, and then you have a collection of like. Right now, I think I have 9 ghosts, so I can spawn in a ghost 9 times, and that takes resources that you build up in the game, like points, like how well you're doing. You can spend those points on getting a ghost.
Gotcha.
So next, you know, and so it's kind of weird, you know, but. Then I got this like a sword ghost, which is a special version of one. And I bring it out, and then I started lagging, and I died, and the ghost blew up, and then that's it.
Yeah,
you know, and then it's really frustrating. It's like it's really frustrating, you know. And if you just
so when it works back, though, is it fun? Like, have you ever had like a cool like series of moments or anything?
I think the cool series of moments were just the moments where I say, "Hey, I did okay there." Like it's when
gotcha.
I just when I'm not dying a ton when I like get 3 kills.
That's adjusting
dying.
To the game as well too.
It is, and I am enjoying it the more I play it. So
okay,
it'll be better. But I think the big thing is you know it just doesn't. It's not Halo. Like none of my skills from the previous games are moving over to this. It's and unfortunately my interest is not exactly moving over to this one as well.
Well, hopefully, as things go along and it cooks a little more,
yeah,
that'll change.
It just, yeah. The whole thing feels strange. Campaign though could end up being
story
good.
Of my life, man.
So that's there you go.
Bungie's Halo is going away. It's time for 343's Halo to come in.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, I guess that's really what's happening here.
I just remembered what I was going to talk about. Paris, the montage at the beginning of the Sony's press conference, they showed Doom. I was expecting Doom news. It wasn't there.
The alpha's coming out pretty soon. Doom, just hold your horses, news. Pal.
The alpha already came out.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go.
I wasn't invited.
Boo.
I guess you could say anyone who's hoping for Doom news is doomed.
No.
All right, I'm done.
That's like,
get out.
Dads would groan at that.
Yeah, I know. Whatever dad jokes are, I've achieved one tier above that. And I'm so ashamed that my shame has become excitement.
All right, let's wind this down.
Are you about to wrap up?
I'm not about to wrap up. There's still like two more segments.
Okay, they're for
really
sure.
Quick. It's adding to the pile of games to play.
Do you want to talk about yours now?
No, I'll do it at the end. I'll do it as a closeout.
Do we have time to talk about Until Dawn, or shall I wait till another day?
We'll wait until another day. We're not talking about what we're playing.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's add one to the pile.
All right. So everyone should play Rocket League.
I think everyone is playing Rocket League still.
I think people are playing it right now. I know. If people are on the edge of playing Rocket League, you should play Rocket League.
Yeah, it's so great. We've stopped talking about how great Rocket League is for a while, but like, let this be a reminder.
Yes. There's a new patch coming out with all these added like custom game modes.
Really?
So
one of them is hockey.
Well, because the last patch that just added a bunch of like car skins, that pissed me off. Like,
yeah.
It didn't affect the gameplay in any way. There's nothing
but
new
it was
about
also
matches.
$3.
Yeah. So yeah. But I mean, it's like I wasn't mad because I don't have to buy it. I was just hoping for something more.
So yeah, you said hockey. I saw one where the ball is now a square.
What?
Yeah. So there's
how mind blowing that was to you.
Just. that's called Nick mode, right?
Yeah, Nick mode.
It's called Nick mode, right?
Nick mode.
Because he's a square.
I'm reaching critical mass of crappiness. Continue. I'm sorry.
But yeah, so play that game. Really great. Can't wait for that new update. Connor, you were going to say something?
About concert. Adding one to the pile?
No, you were going to say something else.
Oh, okay.
The Final Fantasy concert.
Oh, well, thanks for allowing me to intro my...
Sorry.
I'm just kidding. Life goes on. But
you know what? We could bleep that.
All right, we'll bleep it.
Just bleep all of my dialogue in this podcast. Anyways, so I went to see. So usually the Final Fantasy Orchestra is it's called a Different Worlds,
Distant Worlds,
and yeah. So this one is called a New World.
Ooh,
it's basically I think it's the same people. I'm sure some of the musicians rotate in and out, but they wanted to do a bunch of songs that weren't getting any love in the Distant World one. So
okay.
It's like out of a lot of kind of more B-side ones. And first of all, I'll just say they were magnificent. It was they played songs that I knew and songs that I did not know, and they were both equally great. Like, they played a song from Final Fantasy 1.
Wow.
Like,
wow.
Like, I guess just they played a song from Final Fantasy.
Yeah, there you go.
The original. And they played a bunch from, like, 14 and 11 and, like, ones I haven't played. But they played, like, one from 7, 8, 9, 5, 6. I think they did one from every major canon Final Fantasy game. But
cool.
Everything was amazing. One thing I noticed was that, like, a lot of these songs, like, obviously have a lot of emotion and like nostalgia packed into them, but like the way I remember them, it's like through like synthesizers and like 8-bit noises, 8-bit, you know, instruments and
dad.
Sorry, son. So it's like to hear those songs played by like really, really talented musicians that like know how to use dynamics and like just inject the songs with so much emotion. Like, I got a little misty eyed at some parts. Like, the Final Fantasy VIII song they played was the string quartet song.
Which song was it, out of curiosity?
It's like Fragmented Memories, something like that. It's
okay.
I would like hum you the tune, but I mean, that's great radio.
We'll talk about it offline.
Yeah, yeah. I'll tell you which one it was after.
Sure, sure.
I actually got a couple videos that are really
nice.
Sweet. But one thing, I guess my major point I wanted to get at with this is that this concert, like, I just had a giant smile on my face the entire time. And it's like, it brought me back to like when playing RPGs and like games like that, like really like meant something to me.
Totally.
And like, I feel like gaming at times, not all the time, like with me, like gets to a place where it's almost just like trying to achieve like a feeling like you're like chasing some high, you know, where you're like when I play Heroes of the Storm, yeah. It's like, oh, I want to feel that rush when you get like a three-way kill. But right. Like back in the day, like games used to be like an investment or like
they were special, right? They all
kind they of were kind a journey. Yeah. And like the really great parts that were really rewarding of those, like of those games, like you had to work for, and there were like, you had to like sacrifice and stress and like plan, and you were rewarded with these great moments and like with these amazing songs being played over those moments that just like cement them in your heart. And like,
totally,
like hearing all these songs played by the orchestra, like brought me back to the time when like I really looked forward to like what I was going to learn next in like these, right. Like these RPGs that I was
what
playing.
The next it's town
like,
we're going to in FF7.
Right. It's like, right. It just brought back the magic, and it made me want to play more like RPGs, just because like back it's like when games had more, I don't know, it's tough,
charm, it's, soul, I know what
tough,
you mean,
it's I'm, tough to pick a word, yeah. There, but I would say soul, yeah, that's a good one.
That's kind of what I do. I'm always chasing the next great JRPG. Unfortunately, yeah. I get a lot of crap because there have been a lot of good ones, but then every once in a while you get like a Nino Kuni or something, you know what
right
I mean?
Right, it's like gaming so much, it's like these days it's like staring at the screen with glazed eyes just mashing buttons, but it's like it used to not be that way, you know. You used to be looking at the screen with eyes bright, you know, full of excitement and wonder. And that's what RPGs are all about, like great RPGs, of course. And yeah, the concert just reminded me of how important that is and why I play video games. So I just want to say thank you to the New Worlds Orchestra. You were fantastic.
That's why.
And I'm really mad that your CD is $45.
Yeah. Jeez.
Because I really wanted that CD.
And then that's why I've been buying a lot of JRPGs on the PS1 that I haven't played, because I want to try them all. That's what I've missed.
Oh, and guys, since we're talking about RPGs, me and Casey, you guys, listeners of who've been listening for a long time, remember him, is coming onto the show. Me and him are going to have a segment. We're thinking monthly, so we could really dig into these games, where we discuss classic old RPGs in ways that we explore them in ways you may not have seen before. So we're going to be coming out with a new side little YouTube series. So hopefully that should be coming out soon. We got a bunch of plans. We got outlines for our first few episodes. So
I'm excited. That's fantastic.
We're ready to start filming that. So, yeah, for all my RPG fans out there, we got some cool stuff coming for you. So stay tuned.
Quick aside, was Uematsu at the concert?
He was not, because it's a long tour. But the guy, Oh, I'm sorry. I don't mean to stretch on. There's one anecdote I have to share with you guys and the podcast listeners.
Okay.
So they closed. They hadn't played a single FF7 song the whole night.
Oh,
and
wow.
So like everyone's getting nervous, right? And so he's like
sweating.
Yeah, he's like because the conductor's like talking to the crowd in between songs and explaining like the origins of songs and like just cool facts. He was a really funny guy. He was like obviously very excited about the music, so it was like really fun. It was a great atmosphere. And like near the end, he goes, "Okay, we're approaching the end of our concert." And so everyone's like, "Oh crap!" And so he says, "We're gonna finish with a classic called One Winged Angel,"
oh, nice.
Which is the Sephiroth final battle song from FF7, which is iconic to say the least.
Yeah.
The Sephiroth. And so he turns to the crowd and goes, "Okay, so you don't see an orchestra or a chorus up here.
Nice.
With you,
so do you?
So we're gonna." It's Halloween. We got to do something a little special. So you guys are going to be our chorus. And so he had us practice. They were playing the song. He would turn around, point to us, and like mouth it. And the entire crowd, like this two-level, you know, orchestra audience, just all in unison going, "Sephiroth" in the song.
And so
like
awesome.
Everyone did it perfectly.
That's
like
so
nobody
cool.
messed up. It went up like without a hitch.
Fantastic.
And like I filmed the whole thing. So
awesome. I can't wait to watch that.
Yeah, so I'm stoked to tell you guys about that. But yeah, it was a wonderful concert. And yeah,
oh my gosh,
play RPGs, people.
If we could check rights and make sure that that's okay, I would. Anyone who's listening to this, I'm sure, kind of wants to see that. Maybe we could post that to the page. We could try and see if that's possible.
You put it on the page. I don't know about the YouTube channel.
We can't do it on YouTube.
Okay.
Facebook,
we'll,
nobody gives a crap.
We'll see about that.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
Just because that's really cool.
So let's wind this down.
Yeah, great
end.
Episode, everybody.
It was really good.
Yeah.
What?
I did have one more thing. Yes. Sorry, because you reminded me of it. About Halo 5. And it's done, I promise.
Looking at you.
Kazuma Jinouchi is the new composer for it. And
beautiful.
What?
Beautiful.
Oh my god, it's really incredible what he did. So Marty O'Donnell and Michael Salvatore, they did the original trilogy and they did the songs for that. All of the iconic, the really iconic sounds for Halo, because there's a whole cult following for the Halo music as well.
Right.
And so all of the beautiful music composed by them, it was great. They did a great job, and it's going to be really, it's hard to beat those, right?
Mm-hmm.
Halo 4 was Neil Davidge. It doesn't really sound like Halo stuff, but it's its own thing. It's a very sci-fi-y kind of thing. And it's
just
like,
got to acquire the new taste.
It's mm-hmm. good. It just doesn't sound like the old stuff. Mm-hmm. Kazuma Jinochi, this sounds like the new stuff. This sounds exactly like
it should.
What it should be. And
yeah.
What's amazing is that he makes these songs, and if you like, I'm saying this is the one time you should look at YouTube comments and read them, because people are like crying on their keyboards, like, it's so beautiful, and they're looking like, you know, at this second it's like Halo 2 theme and you hear it in the background, and then they like he puts in the Halo 3 song going in there, right, and then they both close out, and then it goes back to the original Halo 1, and then like it goes through, and it is such a medley, it's such like a tribute to all these games, and he actually incorporated the Halo 4 music as well, which I was surprised at, but he does it fantastically. It's just everything about it is so gentle and so well done.
People outside the video game community don't give like game music composers enough credit. Like,
oh my gosh,
for the work
like
they
my
do.
Favorite tracks like ever.
Like Last Night was just further evidence of that fact. But anyways, yep. Fun episode, yep. Guys. Let's wrap it up.
Go for it. Thanks for listening. Be sure to comment, subscribe, and tell us what your favorite game music is all. Game music you like. Could be from JRPGs. Could be from FPS. Could be from anything. Mm-hmm. Be sure to follow us on Twitter at LHG Podcast. And what's our Facebook again?
The Last Honest Gamer? Is that it?
I think Last Honest Gamers or something like that. Something.
How do we not know this?
Because it's been so long since we've used this.
Mm-hmm. Whatever. You'll see the links. Just look below. Yeah. You'll see the links.
And also, LHG Live on Twitch. We're trying to stream every day.
Yeah, and iTunes.
We should actually be having one stream every day. Potentially not Monday or Tuesday. We'll see, but we should have about one a day. So be sure to keep an eye on our Twitter and Facebook and subscribe on Twitch and see the notifications.
Show some love.
Yep. And we'll close it out with a classic song from Final Fantasy Tactics called Antidote. Be sure to like it.
Oh, classic.